From an inside tip the other day, we learned of a gentleman who has probably one of the most interesting and permanent stories that exists in a very transient Hollywood. We're talking this morning with Mr. James Swinnerton, a gentleman who is probably as much a part of California and Lower California history as anyone who lives here now or who has lived here within the past 50 or 60 years. Mr. Swinnerton, when did your history with the state of California start?
I was born in 1875 in Eureka, in the northern part of the state. And later on, I came down to the middle of the state to be educated, San Francisco and Stockton and so forth, and the newspaper business, and then came down to Southern California to pass out with the TB, so I considered that I had covered the state fairly well, and here I am.
You came down to pass out with TB. How many years ago was it when they gave you up as a lost tuberculosis case?
Oh, that's just about 50 years ago. And they exaggerated it a bit. There were three doctors who gave their opinion that I had a month to live, and the last 3 years, I got the last one of them. He was the youngest one. So he's passed on, and that filled my hand, or unfilled it, whichever way you want to put it. So now I'm free to go myself.
And not only that, but if you need one, you'll have to get a new doctor, won't you? Mr. Swinnerton, how have you occupied the last 40, 50 years of your time? What brought you down here, besides tuberculosis, what brought you down to this part of California in the first place?
As I say, I came down here to get over the TB. I was brought out from New York. I was on the comic supplement there, in fact, helped with the first comic supplement in the United States back there when there were only four of us on it. And incidentally, I might say that it was considered a rather poor venture. We didn't expect it to succeed at all. But it went on, and now has become, I believe, the six times the general reading matter in the United States, that it's looked over by at least six more people than do any other one thing.
Well, when you started out working in what was to become the part of the paper that everybody turns to first on Sunday morning, what were some of the, if it was considered to be a poor financial venture, what were some of the arguments that you and the other people who produced the first colored supplements ran into in presenting this as a valid type of journalism, a valid type of humor?
Same thing is happening right now. Cost of material, inks, and labor. It was considered then as being absolutely too high.
Mr. Swinnerton, it strikes me that the job of a cartoonist, judging from your earlier conversation, must have been an extremely important one in the days when newspapers had no other source of pictorial or graphic information to use in their papers.
Yes, it affected a tremendous amount of people. And we were considered as the more or less the same as moving picture stars are now. and autographs to look for, this, that, and the other. But with very few exception, we tried to keep quiet about the whole thing because we knew that we were still artists. An artist didn't have any too good a reputation in church circles and all that sort of thing.
What do you feel is the relative position of, getting away from the straight humor side, your political cartoonists today, people who devote their artistry to other things than pure humor, the people who try to draw cartoons which have an impact on public opinion, either for political reasons or other reasons. What is their position in your mind compared to what it was 40, 50 years ago?
Foundationally, there was a man named Nast who was a cartoonist for Harper's Weekly way back. And it became known that he would not be moved or swerved from his own opinion. He could not be hired to do anything except what he really thought, believed in. And as such, he built up a terrific reputation for the political cartoonists of his time. After that, things were not the same. They were changed again along the line, and they found that people hired to write or to do cartoons the same as they would hire an editorial writer to write an editorial on a certain way. And so gradually it has got down until their influence is merely marked by what you see, and no particular credit is given to their own opinions or so forth.
So that you feel then that it's more or less gotten to the point where the cartoon is a product of an assignment which the cartoonist was given rather than an expression of his own particular beliefs and opinions on any subject that he cared to comment on graphically.
It has gradually worked into that situation, I'm sure. Whether or no it will, we will find somebody come along that will have the strength and the times will permit, we may have another one the same as Nast, but he was the one who did the whole thing.
Mr. Swinnerton, can you comment for a little bit for us about your life and work as a member of the Hearst organization? I understand, and I know from your comments, that you were a good friend and perhaps even a confidant of William Randolph Hearst.
Well, we were friends in a way. But as far as being confidence, I don't know whether we, either one of us, trusted each other or give a hoop. But Mr. Hearst happens to be a marvelous friend. His charities and the nice things that he's done along the line that have never been published or even mentioned, numerous, too numerous to mention. He was a remarkable chap in so many different ways, and yet at the same time was just simply neighborly, friendly, and inclined to believe in you, in the good part of you. He insisted, though, on having folks around him who loved humor. And in all of the articles and books that have been done about him, you find no mention of this whatsoever, although it constituted at least an eighth of his life.
Isn't it true that, to a very large extent, Mr. Hearst was what you might call the father patron of humorous cartoon art as we know it today because of his support?
Yes, he took an intense interest in it, owing, as I say, also to his love of humor, good, clean humor. And he nurtured the thing along and saw that it had every chance in the world as far as publishing was concerned, right up to the day of his death. He was a man who will be known as one of the finest Americans. He stood up for our country at all times, against all opposition, and against a great number of things which might have happened and didn't, owing to his influence back of the scenes. If there's one thing that they can say about Mr. Hearst was he was one of the most ardent Americans that we could have had all his life.
Going now to the family life of those little people who have flown from the end of your pen and from the hairs of your brushes over the years, namely the Canyon Kids, and I believe the Yellow Kid was one of the Yellow Kid.
Little Jimmy.
Oh, that's right. And the I was thinking of the kittens. The
Mr. Jack.
Yeah, that's right, the Tigers. That's it. Looking at that, all the hues of yellow up there is what followed me up. Let me see, how did I start that line? I'm going to do this over. Let's talk a little bit now, Mr. Swinnerton, about the family life of the Canyon Kids and the Tigers and little Jimmy and his friends and his dog. Can you tell us a little bit about them? There are a good many people in our audience, I imagine, who are perhaps too young to have been very closely associated with those cartoon strips. Can you tell us a little bit about them?
Well, little Jimmy has been running for the longest time of all, and that is a little boy who was sent to do an errand, forgot the errand, and did something else, and so naturally that happened in every family, so as some folks said, I've got my little Jimmy in the family, and that made it rather important. And so it is very favorably known along the lines. Not a terrific hit, but kept going. As far as good housekeeping was concerned, I was had been out in and out with the Indians for about 50 years, so I knew them and the family life and all that sort of thing, especially the Southwestern bunch. And I thought I found some things there that might be of interest to other children. That proved to be so. So that had a little, rather a merry and happy life for quite a few years. And still once in a while pops up, so forth. And about the whole situation of comic drawing. Those of us who have kept the faith, in other words, have tried to keep away from tragedy, blood and thunder, and this and that and the other, which are merely exciting to kids and not too pleasing. Why, those of us who have kept the faith, we can look back on it, and if we have any chance to be proud at all, we can be a little bit proud of having kept the faith with a child, and kept it clean, and as near as would suit grandfather and grandmother as possible.
How do you feel about people such as the father of Terry and the Pirates, the fellow who was sufficiently foresighted to predict through the cartoon strip, Buck Rogers, a good many of the things which actually came to pass, and other people who have either been prophetic or somewhat historic in their presentations? How do you feel about that type of the so-called cartoon strip?
All right, well and good. Everything changes every moment. That's the history of the world. And so we've got to make ourselves used to these changes as well as we can. For instance, we had an awful kick coming about the Cats and Jammer Kids for a long time that it suggested more or less ludicrous things did things that nice little children didn't do, and so forth. And even Buster Brown was considered to be too fresh and a little bit too forward. We've had kicks all the way down the line. So now, of course, as long as we're in that age where every child of four must have a gun on his hip and tell you to fall down when he says at you, why, I suppose that that is okay. The kids seem to get along just the same.
I know. I've had the feeling when you look at the newspaper on Sunday morning and look at the cartoon section, if you stop to think a little bit, you wonder to yourself, now, what's funny about this? This is supposed to be a cartoon strip. And in some cases, it's about as funny as a rubber crutch. And may have some other value, but in some cases, I've often wondered about applying the name cartoon or funny paper to some of these things.
That has been distorted right along.
Well, Mr. Swinnerton, what about this situation? Now, how the people in the audience who'll be hearing this program are very familiar with the cartoon, the animated cartoon which they see on television, the animated cartoon which they see before the main program in motion picture houses. How do you feel about the method in which these are being done today and about their effect on, well, not only the youngsters, but people in general?
As long as they're treated as a matter, as a story, and not the real thing, why, they don't have too much. They're merely interesting, like we like to read adventure stories, we elders, I mean, and... we found out, we thought we were doing the comic supplement when we first started it. We thought we were doing it for children. And that was in our minds. And we didn't want to, give them bad examples and all that sort of thing and try to keep away from it. But I happened to be on an elevated train in New York one time on Sunday morning, and a bunch of kids were on there, and they had their Sunday supplements, and they were looking over things that we had thought were humorous, and there was not a smile on their faces. And so I went to my editor that day afterwards, and I said, "Do you know, we've been all wrong. We think that those kids are laughing at our stuff." I found out a whole carload of them. Well, had no idea of laughing. They were looking for the interesting part of it. They were looking for the story. And the elders would laugh, but not the kids. And so it is the natural thing for it to get to be a sort of a half and half. The funny part, so-called, for the elders, but the kids were still looking and are still looking to this day for the story in it. That's what they're interested in most.
Along that same line, Mr. Swinnerton, how do you feel about the young, the kid, if you will, public today in their appreciation and in their search for entertainment or interest from cartoons? Are they more difficult to please than they were 30 or 40 years ago? Are they interested in different things than they were 30 or 40 years ago?
Certainly. Kids have to, the ways of children have to change along with the times. I have an ancestor back in Salem who was a witch judge. He was also a quack doctor. And my first publicity agent was Nathaniel Hawthorne. He used him in the House of the Seven Gables in the Scarlet Letter. And if he... couldn't get the best of them with his quack doctrine, why, then he could sit on the witch judge bench and shove them off that way. Well, that was so he had them coming and going in a Western expression, and that was my idea of Dr. John Swinnerton of Salem, who was buried in the Charter Street burying ground, he and his WIDDO. And so now, then he was a very respected and marvelous citizen, and had a picture done in oil and a big gilt frame around it in the Holy of Holies in Salem. And now he would be put in jail.
You're a man who has entertained and pleased the eye and the mind of all sorts of people because of the very Catholic scope of your artwork, starting out with black and white cartoons, going to colored comic supplements in both single frame and multiple frame form, and going on into the field of oil painting, which you have enriched to a very high degree with your pictures of desert life, the high desert, the low desert, the desert with Indians and without Indians, still lives and some which have so much depth to them that they almost seem to come to life. How did you happen to switch from the pen to the brush in your artwork?
Well, I didn't exactly switch. It was in my mind all the time, as did the stuff, Indian stuff in Good Housekeeping magazine, for instance. The backgrounds were quite there, with the, and that was figures. But I have kept to strictly to the landscape, and I took up desert painting because first it gave me my health back in the TB situation by going to the desert. And second, I thought was the very much misunderstood land. It's the most despised of all landscape. And although my friends all wanted me to paint the Sierras and all that sort of thing with the nice trees and brooks and so forth, I still stuck to the desert because I thought I found some beauty there. And 50 years ago, I couldn't have gotten only a very few people to go in with me. Much less would I suggest that there was some beauty there. They thought I was crazy. And they've been throwing rocks at me for 20 or 30 years. And now I have the satisfaction of knowing that I find them out there with their color cameras and nice old ladies under umbrellas painting and all sorts of people out there seeing the beauties of the desert that they never would have seen 50 years ago. They called it just simply a drab heck hole and had absolutely devoid of beauty.
You went down, according to an article I read earlier this morning, to Palm Springs in 1903, the first time, I believe. Today, Palm Springs is a beautiful place in a good many parts because of the modern beautification of swimming pools and girls in bikinis and golf courses and neon signs, if those will ever be beautiful. What was it like 60 years ago?
There was about 14 white people and 24 Indians. And we had a lot of fun. Everybody was there. Nearly everyone was ill with something or other, generally TB. And they were all at loggerheads, more or less, but they all had to stick together to help each other. And so it was a queer combination. The Indians were merely on the sidelines and looked it over and wondered how the whites could talk against each other and yet had to get together as soon as they had a pain in the neck.
What was it like physically? Were you living in log huts or hogans or tents or under cactus branches, or how was it?
Tent houses. Tent house was a tent that was put, they put a flooring down the same size and then just put it up so it would stand the wind a little bit better, and took away the ropes on the sides. And the more affluent had two or three tent houses put together, and there were a few houses, but they were the shake variety, and they were got blown away every once in a while.
Another place that is now the living land of neon and macadam streets and beautiful women is Las Vegas, Nevada. I understand that you spent a good deal of time there, about 6 years, I think you told me, a number of years back. What was it like then?
Well, I took an interest in Las Vegas, passing through on the old Salt Lake line, and looked out the window, and they said it was Las Vegas, and I saw a bunch of roofs laying on the ground. And I took an interest in the place from that time on. And when I was on my way to New York by Salt Lake, and I swore that I'd sometime look in there and find out why and just how roofs could get laid out so neatly as they were. And so that is the reason that years and years afterwards I went to Vegas and stayed there. I was intended to stay about a week or two, but stayed 6 years. Did the same thing in Flagstaff, Arizona. And so that is the way I would settle down, as it were.
What was the story on these roofs that were flat on the ground? Was the house dug down underneath them in the ground?
No, they just had one of their little breezes, they called them, up there in And so they'd found out how to anchor them a little bit better, and that's the reason they're building them so heavy and high and all that sort of thing now, so they'll stay.
Mr. Swinnerton, you were telling us a little earlier about the gathering of cartoonists, which 600 of them got together and had a dinner. I understand that you and Rube Goldberg, whose name is a sort of a family word for any contraption, has become a Rube Goldberg. I understand that Mr. Goldberg got up and told a story about his early life, which was pretty interesting. Would you tell it to us?
Well, this poor audience of draftsmen of various sorts had to listen to the two of us whether they wanted to or not. We were just two old souls sitting up there. And Rube got up and told this one on me before I could get mine in first. He said that when he was up in San Francisco, where I came from, by the way, why, he wanted to do some drawing. He was just starting in up there at that time. And his mother was for him, like so many mothers are for a boy like Rube. But his father had worries. And his father said, "Now, Rube," he says, "I want you to remember one thing before you make a step like that." He said, "You know that Swinnerton kid that draws around here? And he drinks too much, and he gets in lots and lots of trouble, and he's always on the go, and he wears loud clothes, if he can get them. Now, he said, that kind, he says, that he draws. Now, he said, that kind don't live too long." And it seems that Rube, on this occasion, was 80 years old, and I was 88. And so that was the best that Rube could do about drawing.
What was the story that you were going to tell that Rube Goldberg beat you to? Did you have one that you had planned to tell in case he hadn't had a chance to upstage you and tell his first?
Well, there was a situation that used to come up. It was not a single situation when we were first drawing for a comic supplement back even to Rube. Young couples would introduce their children, their little children, to us and say, "This is the person who draws those pictures that your daddy reads to you on Monday morning in the newspaper, in those funny pictures." And a couple like that came up to me one time, and they had a little bit of a five-year-old. She was a very dainty, nice little creature. And the mother was exuberant over having her meet me, and thought we might use her, I think. And the father, he was nice too. And while they were saying things like, "You want to know, this is the man that makes those pictures that you laugh at and they're so happy over on Monday mornings." And I could notice that her face was pretty serious, and at last a great big tear dragged out of her eyes when she took a look at me. And then she ran, grabbed her mother's skirts, and hid out behind him and says, "No, no, no, no," and burst out crying. So that is the way that my first audiences took me as far as looks was concerned, and I've looked like that ever since.
At the other end of the spectrum, from the little girl that cried when she first saw the father of the cartoons that her dad read to her on Sunday mornings, is the story about the lady or her husband who was looking at one of your oil paintings and had something else to say. What was that story?
Well, that was merely a lady had selected a painting of the Grand Canyon. And I painted it very faithfully, did a good hard job on it, which one has to do with the Grand Canyon. You can't put a dot and a cross, and three or four more dots and in a corner and call it Grand Canyon and put it across even now. And that's saying something. Now, the painting was delivered, and she expected him to have a grand time over it. He looked at it, and then he looked rather aghast for a few moments, his first view of it, and then he warmed up to the thing, knew he'd better, I guess, on account of her, and did a very fair job of admiring it and being tickled to death over having received it. And I wondered about this thing, and so I kept around for a while, and after I'd known him better, well, then I said, "You had a queer expression on your face and when you first saw that present from your wife." But he said, he looked around a few moments and here and there, and at last he said, "I think I know you well enough to tell you the truth." He says, "Thank heaven," he says, "you did it well enough," but he said, "you did it a little bit too good." He says, "I have claustrophobia," and I says, "I can't stand to look from high places," and you'd made it look as though it was really a long way down to the bottom, which explained it.
Question that comes to my mind is if there's any particular significance in the fact that your tigers, your characters in Little Jimmy, and your characters in The Canyon Kids, the key characters, were all little teeny people. Is there any particular significance in the fact of their diminutive size?
No, not especially. Children rather like to see what the other fellow does, especially if it's humorous or interesting, and also the parents. So if you want to be a popular caricaturist or a popular comic draftsman, well, select the subject which pleases the most people.
A thought came to the back of my mind that I thought perhaps maybe you were drawing these people down at the size of the people whom you were trying to get to because of the old thing about don't talk down to children, and certainly you weren't talking down to them pictorially since you were presenting characters their own size. Can you tell me a little bit about your likes and dislikes and activities today? Who, for instance, are among your favorite cartoonists of the day, and what are your chief interests as the days go by?
Well, every old person has certain ideas, and they should be stopped instead of encouraged when they start to talk on any one of them. And the only thing that I have brought along, I counted 37 boys. Ripley, Bob Edgwin, we could go on and on and on. And some illustrators, too, are all in the game. And the only one thing that I've ever told them that ever did them any good, as far as I know, was to go through that terrible experience of telling them how much work they've got to do before they really can be a successful person.
Well, at the tender age of 88, I don't see any halt in your step or any kink in your back or any quaver in your hand, as is so amply testified by the partially finished oil painting you have on your easel here in the studio where we're talking. And since every interviewer always asks the person to whom he's talking, if there's any case of a little bit of advanced age, to what do you attribute not so much your longevity but your excellent state of health at this 88 years of age?
Well, everything has been very kindly towards me as far as I can see, and I've cheated them, I think, along about 40 years. And I have been very lucky. I've been allowed to go on out and appreciate nature. The real thing about painting is, I think, that one should show, not try to help nature or to differ with it, but find out all you can about it, because there's never-ending things, perfections and symphonies, all showing that everything is doing for the best, changing every moment as it has been for millions of years. One thing or another, at last we learn that nature is a great symphony, a great and marvelous thing, and when we think we know a lot, we can pause for a moment and think what we don't know, and that'll put us in proper value and balance.
Thank you very much, Mr. James Swinnerton.